Hey guys, today we're going to be changing out our time and chain tensioner. To do this job, the first thing you want to do is remove the negative terminal off the battery and also remove the accessory drive belt. So on the G35 and the 350Z, this is the tensioner pulley, and you have to loosen it yourself. If you watch the video of my truck, it's self-tensioning, it's just spring-loaded, much easier to deal with, but this is what we have to deal with. So this is why we take off the negative terminal on the battery, because I'm working near the electric fans. And I've also sprayed some fluid film on here to help loosen up, or you can use some sort of penetrating lube. I like using fluid film because I'm reusing these belts and it's safe for rubber. I try not to get anything on the plastic parts, but it is safe. So it's gonna take a couple turns. It's much easier with a breaker bar. It's a little bit tight in here as well because of our aftermarket radiator and fan. All right, now that you guys have seen the drive belt and I've loosened up the locking nut, let's go ahead and put the car in there and do everything from underneath. Also, when you're closing your hood, don't do what I do sometimes. Put the battery cover back on. Let's close the hood. So underneath the vehicle, you will have to remove the belly pan. I've already gone ahead and done that because I'm doing some other work on the car. So here is our tensioner bolt. Just taking a 12 millimeter. And now we'll be able to loosen this. Now, before you go ahead and loosen the tensioner and remove the drive belt, take some pictures of the layout of how it's on the vehicle. Unless you do this all the time and have it memorized, make sure you take down notes and pictures. That way it's gonna make your life easier when you reinstall the belt. So you guys can see when it's loose. I'm sure you can tell on camera, but you can see the pulleys coming down. Doesn't take a lot. Now we can go ahead and remove this. Now, if you had to service the belt for the air conditioning, you'd still have to pull this one off, and then you'd go over to this side over here, and then you'd loosen this one the same manner. While the belt is off, now's a good time to inspect all the pulleys. Check for play. Obviously, this one's gonna have a bunch of play because you have it loosened. So this is the power steering pump, this is your alternator, this is an idler pulley. So if it's making a whirring sound, you might need to replace something. But it's a good time to check it now because when it's on the vehicle, it might be hard to detect, especially when the belt has tension on it. So with these things are just free play, now's a good time to look at them. This step is completely optional. So for the idler pulley, now that I have everything loose, I'm gonna spray just a little bit of fluid film in here. And I'm gonna rotate it. I'm gonna do that a couple times. That way, the bearings inside can get a little bit lubricated just to get a little more life out of it before I put the belt back on. But I also wanna make sure that I clean the pulley itself afterwards with some brake clean, spray it onto the rag, clean the pulley. Fluid film is okay on plastic and rubber parts, but I'd still rather have this clean so nothing touches the belt. You can see with the drive belt removed, we have a lot more room to work. So we have this access port right here, which leads me to believe that Nissan knew that this is kind of a serviceable item. There is more than one timing chain tensioner on this car. We have them up here, but this is the big main one. And you know, it's going to go through abuse over the years. And Nissan was kind enough to put an access port here because they didn't have to. They could have just been like, well, you got to change that part out when you have to change out the whole timing chain. And this is kind of why I like pushrod engines more. Technically, there are more parts, but those parts are typically easier to service. This one's forgiving, like I said, but if we had to change out the whole timing chain, if you look at a small block Chevy or an LS motor, a timing chain is very small and virtually never wears out. Well, the timing chain on this or like a Ford, it's this huge thing. So we're gonna remove these three bolts. Ahead and remove the cover. Also remove any plugs that might be in your way. Now there is a gasket maker on there, so you're probably gonna have to persuade the cover to come off. So just take your time and work the material. You just need to get a little bit of it started and then you take off my hand. I'd rather take off my hand if I can here. Because one, tool doesn't really fit. Two, I don't want to be hitting so much of the gasket maker into there. I am going to change the oil right away after, but we obviously want to avoid getting any debris into the engine. So here you guys can see is the timing chain tensioner. So there's two 10 millimeter bolts that hold it in. So we're going to remove those. Now, if it doesn't want to come out, you might have to rotate the crank a little bit in order to relieve some tension off the chain. Okay, be very attentive here and keep your fingers on the fasteners. This is why it's good to invest in magnetic sockets sometimes. So I'm keeping track of this bolt the entire time because I do not need it going into the engine. So my plan of attack is I'm not prying on any of the aluminum of the vehicle. So my screwdriver is hitting the body of the tensioner and then the screwdriver is on the cam case over here, the timing chain case. I do not want to start gouging out the aluminum because you might have a bad seal or you're just going to get particles back into the engine. Now to get a little bit of slack in the chain, you just have to rotate the crank. So we just have a 19 millimeter socket on a breaker bar and I can adjust it. I'll show you guys what we mean. So looking at the chain, you see I have some play in it. See how I can move it? So this is the guide that the chain rides on. So we also want to inspect it. Make sure it's in good condition. We don't want to see big marks on it or anything or abrasion marks in it, because that would be indications that it's worn out. Then you might have to get into a timing chain job. So you can either do it yourself or pay a technician to do it. But we can't get our new tensioner in if this doesn't have slack. If you cannot move this over, you're not gonna have any luck. Well, if you can't really, if there's no slack on it, you probably don't even have the tensioner out yet. So once you get as much slack as you can get out of it, then you go ahead and reinstall it. So in the meantime, we're just gonna do a visual inspection, make sure that everything looks okay in here. And then we're gonna have to clean out this area. You can see this is where the factory gasket maker is. We have to get all of this out and clean it before we can install everything. So we're slowly working the body out. So you just have to be really patient with it. Don't freak out. Like, if you can't get that to push in and then you loosen it and then it just like, it'll spring out and then it'll be really tight. And you're like, oh no, I can't get out my hand. Take your time, breathe, work the crank a little bit, see if you can get some tension off that chain and slowly massage it out. Don't pry it out, massage it out from the backside. So if this was how it was in the vehicle, I was on the back corner here. And I was making sure, the main thing was I was looking to make sure that this was in the actual opening. If it's behind the opening, you're not gonna make any, you're not gonna get any movement, you're probably gonna damage the cover. If it's through the opening, you just have to massage it out because your fingers can't produce enough force. So we're removing the top portion of the gasket maker off of the cover. Put a rag or something to make sure everything you're taking off doesn't go in here. Now you could be careful, it'll most likely just come out here, but you want to make sure that you're doing your very best to make sure there's no debris going inside your engine. And then just take your time. You might want to take a pick for this little galley right here, because this is where a lot of the gasket maker is going to go. So you want to make sure that's as clean as possible so then the new material can get in there. The rest of the oil residue I'm spraying on to my rag, and then I'm going to come over here and I'm going to wipe away any residue or anything. I don't want to spray it on the engine because I don't want brake clean going in where the oil is. Even though I'll be changing the oil right away, I just don't want to get anything in there. For this job, I'm electing to use genuine Nissan parts. I happen to get this from our local auto parts store. Not sure how they're carrying it, but it is a Nissan part. I just told them I want something from Japan. They said, have you got this one? Cost me 80 bucks. It's a small assurance paid. These are the kind of parts I just wouldn't cheap out on. Just put in the OEM stuff. We know it's gonna work properly. So this job I'm not gonna complete in one evening. I'm just gonna fill this up with the oil that I use. So I use 5W40. And I'm just gonna let this thing soak in overnight. I'm not gonna pull the pin out because that's gonna make my life super hard. You probably don't have to do this, but this is probably the only time I'm ever gonna have to do this in the car. It can't really hurt it. So we'll just let that soak overnight. We also have to make sure that our timing cover is completely clean. So I have to take the time and scrape off all the original gasket that was on there and be careful not to gouge it. We just want to make the surface super clean again. We have now taken all the gasket material off of this, so before we put the cover back on, I'm just going to hit it with some brake clean and we're going to clean all the residue off of it. Remember, we were prying it off, there's oil residue, so we want to get all the debris off of it so it doesn't go back into the engine. Two, we need it as clean as possible so when we use our new gasket maker, it's going to have good adhesion. So to get the tensioner back in, you're going to have to move the chain over, make sure there's slack. You got to get way over. Let me see. All right, so I'm now going to put the tensioner back in so you can see our chain right here. So I'm just going to pull this over the side as much as possible and get the tensioner back in. Quick tip before you guys install the timing chain tensioner, we put a little string and tied it to the pin. That way, in case it gets loose in there because it's starting to push on the piston over here, it doesn't fall into the case. It's highly unlikely it will fall into the case because it's sitting out here, but we don't want to take the chance. Now I want to recap because it was very difficult to film how we put this in. So it did take two people, and what I would do is I would put my hands in there because we reduced the tension as much as we could, and I lifted it up as far as I could. So I would pull the chain up all the way. And then, so my dad helped me out. I ended up using a tool like this, and you can see this area right here. You can hold on to the tension, you can hold on to the guide without damaging anything and hold it into place. This allowed me to put in the top 10 millimeter bolt, and then we could position afterwards by pushing on the casing here with like a pry tool. So we're using this because it's just, it's doesn't have sharp edges. So we're prying on the inside as we can and just moving over just a little bit. Now what we did realize, what you'll find is when you're pushing on this guy, that the pin over here will have no tension and it will get loose. So we had a string attached to it, and that way in case the pin falls out, we can pull it out and it won't go into the timing chain cover. And we're doing everything by hand, so we're just positioning everything and then I'm threading it all by hand. That way I know I'm not cross-threading it, and then I can go ahead and then use that torque wrench. Now to make sure everything's secured properly, I am referring to my service manual here. So I go into the timing chain tensioner bolts, and the primary chain, which is the one that we affected, is 72 inch pounds. All right, so we're now on our home stretch. So when you're buying a gasket maker, make sure it says gasket maker and read carefully and make sure it says it's rated for oil. Next, you want to get a consistent small bead around the cover, and the instructions say to go around the bolt holes as well. So what we're going to do is we're going to hand tighten it and let it sit for an hour, and then we're going to torque it to specification afterwards. So you want to make sure you really take your time. I'm doing my best. I do not want the cover to hit just yet. Now we can go ahead and get a little closer. And then torque this down to specification. Now before you put on the cover, obviously you've torqued down the tensioner to specification, you've checked for any debris, make sure there's nothing in there, everything looks good. And I'm only tightening down the first stage just snug, just till it squishes it out just a bit. So you want to see a little bit of that gasket maker come out. And the instructions stay to wait an hour and then torque it to specification. We have now waited one full hour to let the gasket maker set up. Now we can go ahead and torque it down to manufacturer specifications. Our service manual says to do it at 114 inch pounds. So after we torque it down, I still can't fire up the engine. It wants, this particular material wants me to wait a full 24 hours before driving it or before putting it into service. So since we have to wait for the gasket meter to fully cure, we can still go ahead and plug in anything that we disconnected and also put the accessory drive belt back on. So you refer to your picture that you took before, but you can see that there are ribs on the belt and there's ribs on the pulley. So to make it simple, you just make sure that the belt goes around everything with a rib. So come over here, and then on the idler pulley, or the tensioner I should say, it goes flat to flat. So rib on all the pulleys that are ribbed, flat over here, and then you can go ahead and tighten it. So you don't want to make it too tight, but we're going to go by hand as far as we can. So that's way too loose. It's getting better. So you want it to be feel like there's tension, but it has to have a little bit of play in it when the vehicle's operating. And don't forget to tighten up the locking nut. And once everything's back together, I'm still going to give it a quick wipe down while I'm under here. So before we put our hands in here again, we have to disconnect the negative terminal. 24 to 28 foot-pounds isn't very much at all, it's really just snug. And a lot of you that have a traditional torque wrench and foot-pounds, I have an aftermarket radiator and cooling fans, so I don't have a lot of room in there. You might need some sort of adapters in there, so just keep all these things in mind. Once everything's back together and you've done your inspection, you're confident with everything, go ahead and hook up the battery again. So after everything's tight, we have to check for deflection. Now, we just don't check it and then go. We have to crank over the engine a couple times and then check for any variation deflection again. So to verify our deflection adjustment, there is a maximum, and this is for the alternator power steering that's going to be 7 millimeters. We don't want to be in that. Where they want you to be on a new belt is 3.5 to 4.5 millimeters. So depending on how old the parts are in the vehicle. Now for the air conditioning compressor, the maximum deflection is 12 millimeters, and then a new belt should be 8 to 9. So this one is just an Imperial, you'll have to do the conversion. I like to use a square because I can use another part of the engine to keep it level. And then we can go here and then we can just see how much we're actually getting for deflection on the belt. You could use a tape measure if you can find a good spot. I just find it's a lot easier with a square. All right, let's go ahead and test the car.